Hi, I'm Dave, and I'm the lead pastor here at New Life. And I just want to welcome you to our service. For me, there's no better place to be. And if you'd like to know more information about how to connect and the different things that are going on, make sure you check down below. And hit that like button, hit that subscribe button so you can see new services as they come online. So now, rather than sitting around, let's join in.
Sing a new song to him who sits on
And we're going to continue in this series we've been in called Jesus Changes Everything. And today we're going to be looking at the cost of this change. See, change doesn't happen just in a vacuum, that there's always, if we want to say like a price to pay, there's always a challenge involved, there's always a cost, and what does that look like? And Jesus was very upfront, and we're going to look at it in Luke chapter 9, and really kind of giving us like a warning label, not to stay away from him, but to go, if you follow me, here are some of the things that may happen in your life. Here are some of the things that you're going to face. And Jesus was very upfront about it. It's kind of like when you buy something and there's that little warning label on the side going, okay, this is a really good product. There's all these really good things, but here's some things you need to be aware of. So as I was thinking of that, I thought, well, what better way than to have a quiz this morning and to see if you can figure out some of these warning labels. So you need to be, they're not on your sheet or anything. You just need to be thinking, I'm gonna give you the warning label and then you're gonna tell me what the product is, okay? We are grading this. And so it's actually gonna be graded in heaven. No. So as I give these, just think about it and then I'll ask, you know, if you know what it is. Here's the first one. Caution, may be harmful if swallowed or may cause severe eye irritation if splashed in the eyes. If swallowed, feed milk. If splashed in the eyes, flood with water. Call physician immediately. Anyone know what that is? Bleach, right? Okay. How many of you got that? Yeah, see, good for you. All right, here we go. Here's another one. Danger, extremely flammable, harmful or fatal if swallowed, may affect eyes, skin, and respiratory tract. Gasoline, right? There you go. There it is. How many got gas on that one? See, some of you are 2 for 2. Anybody 0 for 2? Yeah, I know all the rest of you are. So because some of you are 0 for 2, I'm gonna give you like a good one that you're gonna know right off the bat, okay? So you can at least get one. Here it is. Warning, the Surgeon General has determined that these are dangerous to your health, may cause lung cancer, heart disease, and may complicate pregnancy. There we go. You got it up there? There it is. All right, you ready? The last two are gonna get a little more difficult. Here we go. Caution, extremely hot, can cause burns. Keep away from eyes for external use only. Anyone know? It's a curling iron. So I'm just telling you, that's what the warning label says. Don't even ask me about external use only. Warning labels come from lawsuits, so I have no idea what happened on that one there. I'm not even really sure what a curling iron is or what it's for. It doesn't make any sense. All right, here's the last one, number 5, you ready? Warning, ingestion may cause intestinal distress. Prolonged use may lead to severe health issues and or death. Anyone know? McDonald's French fries. There's really not a warning label on those, but we know there's a warning label, right? All right. So as we've been in this series, we have been looking at how Jesus really does change everything. And I know how we can do some external things. We can, you know, exercise and we can go to classes and we can, you know, learn and grow and different things like that. But the true deep change, we recognize that he is the architect and the author of that change. And he calls us to follow him. And when we do, just like if you've been here these last few weeks and we've been looking at like the disciples when Jesus said, come follow me, and they left everything behind. And so we realize when we take that step to truly follow him, not just the, oh yeah, I believe that Jesus, you know, is real and all that. I mean, that we're gonna follow him, that nothing is ever the same. And what he accomplished on the cross and in his resurrection has altered our lives and altered our eternity completely. But Jesus also told us that there is a cost to following him. And it's not just a, hey, business as usual, just believe and go about your life, just, you know, kind of say you believe and then just do whatever you wanna do. No, Jesus calls us to something more.
And contrary to modern packaging and even marketing, Jesus never tried to hide the challenges of following him. Jesus didn't move crowds by making all these wild promises that they were gonna have health and they were gonna have wealth and they were gonna have happiness. And then as the crowds were leaving, he would kind of go, oh, by the way, there may be a few responsibilities and a few sacrifices along the way. Like, he didn't say that under his breath. He was very upfront. In fact, he was so upfront about the challenges of following him that there were times in the Gospels where it literally says this, that many of his followers turned away and deserted him at this point. Like, Jesus was saying things and they were like, hey, we're all in, whoa, wait a minute. I didn't sign up for that. Like, that's how clear Jesus was. And he asked his followers, his listeners, to count the cost of following him. Like, he gave them, if you want to put it in those terms, like a warning label. And so in Luke 14, we're going to get to Luke 9 in just a second, but in Luke 14, Jesus said this, but don't begin until you count the cost. For who would begin construction of a building without first calculating the cost to see if there's enough money to finish it? He's saying, before you go down that road, if you're wise, you're going to say, hey, can we do this or not? Two of our kids live up in Sacramento, and we've traveled back and forth, 99, I-5, both those corridors, many, many, many times. And this doesn't exist anymore, but up until a few years ago, on the west side of the freeway, there was this giant shopping center that was being built. And if you've ever driven up that way over the past few years, you've probably seen it. Acres and acres, just huge. Parking lots, little parking lot islands, all the sidewalks, foundations were poured, some of the initial steel girders were put in place, and then for some reason, and I don't know, it stopped. And for years, this just sat there. It wasn't even really half built, it was partially built, and it sat there and sat there. And you drive by that, and it becomes this monument of, we couldn't see the future. We didn't know what it was gonna be. We had to give up. And it's this picture really that Jesus is talking about here. Because before you do anything like that, you sit down and go, what's this going to cost me? Now, in this larger passage of Luke 14, Jesus actually gives another example too. Same kind of thing. He said, if there was a king preparing to go to war, that king would first sit down and make an assessment of the enemy's strength, and then would make an honest assessment of his own troops' strength before going to war, because the ultimate risk would be to get out there and go, oh man, we had no idea. So you count the cost. And when we choose to follow Jesus, there's a cost. Now, before I go any further down this road, I want to just up front say what Jesus offers us is beyond measure. Just like if you were to look at a product, you know, whether it's that curling iron or bleach or, you know, whatever it might be, those are such minor, silly examples, but you would look and you'd say, hey, I really need this. This is really good. The benefits are amazing for them, but there is a warning for it. But you realize that the benefit far outweighs the warning. It's just something you need to be cautious about. It's something you need to take into consideration. When we look at following Jesus, what he offers us is just no comparison, right? He offers us forgiveness and joy and purpose in life. And he offers us authentic, real life, Jesus said. Life, you know, above and beyond fullness, right? That's what he says. But it's not even the only thing. He adopts us into his family. He restores our soul. He invites us into eternity with him that is so far beyond our imagination. We can only even get small glimpses of what that might be like. And so what we receive from him is so much more than we could ever pay, so much more than we could ever even begin to sacrifice. But Jesus still warns his followers that if you follow me, there is a cost to it. And so he cautioned the people. So it was really clear that when you choose to follow me, Jesus was saying, you're coming on my terms, not your terms. You're surrendering to me. And so Jesus makes no apologies when he asks people, count the cost, read the package carefully. And so he makes both the promises and the responsibilities in kind of clear, bold print, no surprises. And so as we come into this, we realize he is in the business of change and transformation and being reformed into his image. But he says, but understand there are some things that are gonna shift, some warnings that you need to understand. And so we're gonna look in Luke chapter 9 today. And in this passage, we're gonna start in verse 57. There are three encounters that Jesus has. And you see them one after another. When someone will say something and Jesus will answer back. And as you're gonna look at these, you're gonna see these are all warnings, these are all cautions for following him. And I think it's wise for us today to say, what does this look like for me? Because you may be here and go, well, I believe in God. I believe in Jesus. I even believe in the Bible. Great. That belief is the beginning point and is wonderful. I'm not trying to take that away from you. But Jesus says, will you follow me? Will you walk in my ways? Will you trust me in this? That's a different commitment. It's a different step. But what he gives us far outweighs any challenge we might have. So I'm gonna give you three things today. I want you to write these down. These are some of the cautions and the warnings. These are some of the count the cost that we need to be aware of. The first is this: following Jesus may complicate my life. Following Jesus may complicate my life. If you're there in Luke chapter 9, look at we're just gonna do 57 and 58, the first encounter. As they were walking along, someone said to Jesus, I'll follow you wherever you go. But Jesus replied, foxes have dens to live in and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place even to lay his head. Seems like kind of an odd answer, doesn't it, to you? Because if someone came up to you and said, hey, I'm in 100%, I'm gonna follow you wherever you go, you might go, oh, wow, thank you. That is truly an honor, right? And Jesus doesn't say that. Now, I don't think Jesus is angry when he says this. I don't think he's shaking his finger. But he begins to present the reality of what following him looks like. And he says, listen, foxes have dens, birds have that. I don't even have a place to lay my head. There's this complication of living in the way of Christ. There's this complication. Doesn't mean you're not gonna have a home. Doesn't mean you're not gonna have a pillow. That's not what he was getting at. But he was talking about these challenges that come when we say yes to Jesus. Now, maybe you've been in a service or something where you've felt this kind of this excitement, you know, because in this passage, it's like some guy just shouts from the crowd, you know, I'll follow you wherever you want to go. And maybe you've sometimes felt that. Maybe you heard a worship song, or maybe there was a particularly, you know, challenging sermon by someone, I don't know, you know who, that would just challenge you and go, man, I want to follow God with everything I am. And you kind of want to shout that out. That's what this man was saying. But Jesus apparently knew something more about this man's commitment. He was recognizing that it was a more emotional than truthful. And so Jesus answered that foxes and birds, but I don't have a place to put my head. And Jesus was really issuing a warning that following me may present some challenges in your life. Now, it's very possible this man had seen Jesus heal people and feed people, maybe even bring someone back to life. And maybe he had heard Jesus teach and thought, that's it, hands down, I'm going with this guy. This guy is a winner. I've never seen anyone like this. And Jesus says, slow down for a moment. Count the cost. Count the cost. You see, following me will solve some problems in your life. It will bring hope that you can't even begin to imagine, but it's gonna create some problems as well. And we sometimes come to church or an event or something, and maybe we like the music or people are friendly or messages seem targeted right out. I got people say that all the time. It's like they walk out and go, that message was exactly for me. Like, it's like you have a camera in my home. And I'll often say, well, we do. That's how we do that. No, we don't. No, of course not. But that's what the Holy Spirit does, right? He, it's like it targets us and we're just like, wow, this is amazing. And the thing is that following Jesus does bring hope to our life and really does bring solutions to the greatest problems of humanity. Things like guilt and shame and purposelessness. In this, we have a savior and a friend. But again, those things come. Now, some of you are thinking, well, I follow Jesus and there really aren't any complications, really. But I think there are if you thought deeply about it. I want to give you just a couple off, kind of off the top of my head. One is this, and this isn't on your sheet, so I want you just to kind of follow along with me. But one of the challenges and complications is when you follow Jesus, you have a deeper awareness of sin. You have a deeper awareness of sin. Because I will guess before you came to Christ, you kind of lived with your own sense of morality. You just decided, well, no, this is okay. This is just kind of what I want to do. And we often know it by, we'll compare ourselves to others. This is how we know we're living in that realm. We go, well, I know I'm not really great, but I'm not as bad as them. See, we put ourselves on some kind of a scale. Or we say, well, yeah, I know I've done some bad things, but I've done some good things too, right? We're trying to balance out the scale a little bit. But when Jesus becomes the Lord of your life, when he becomes the King of your life, he gives us a new standard. And it's not just, hey, whatever you think is okay is what goes. No, he gives us something more. Here's what it says in 1 Peter. But now you must be holy in everything you do, just as God who chose you is holy. For the scriptures say, you must be holy because I am holy. Now, I know we hear that and go, that's an impossible standard. And in one way, you're right. But in Christ, he makes us holy. He calls us to holy living, holy responses. In John 14, Jesus said this, if you love me, obey my commandments. He didn't say, if you love me, just believe. He didn't say that. Now again, belief is good. This is where we start. But he says, if you love me, you will walk in obedience to the things that I say. And you want to talk about some complications in that? See, when you look back on your life, there are things that we would have done and said or acted in certain ways and thought, hey, it's no big deal. It's just the way I live my life. But as you grow in following after Jesus, you become aware of and sensitive to his desires. You become aware and sensitive to sin and you choose something different. It could be in the shows that you watch or the music you listen to or the social media that you follow. But you come to a point where you say, you sense God saying to you, this isn't for you. I have something more for you, better for you. And when Jesus is the Lord of your life, you start asking this question, how would Jesus have me act? Kind of that whole, what would Jesus do, right? Because followers of Jesus develop this aversion to, this inability to just simply move along with sinful patterns in your life. You're going, no, this isn't right. And we may struggle through it. It may be tension. It may be all of those things and temptations all mixed into that. But we say, I don't want to live like this anymore. Following Jesus complicates that issue. It's a really good thing, but we become more aware of it. Another thing we become aware of is people in a whole different way. See, before we just kind of lived our life, it was all about me and kind of what I want. But when we follow Jesus, there's this growing sensitivity to the needs and the hurts and the wounds of people around us. Could be in your own family. It could be people who are far away. That's why we get challenged to do things like create a shoebox of a Christmas gift for a child on the other side of the world, or serving in our food pantry, or sponsoring a child through like World Vision or Holt, or there's all different kinds. Sometimes it's just the simple interaction day by day of rather than moving on through hurt, we may say to someone at work or at school, can I pray for you? Like you're not preaching at them, you're not doing any of those things. It's just, you realize it's like, you matter. Can I pray for you? And again, these are people that you have to look right in the eye and see the hurt. And when Jesus is Lord of your life, you take a different view of others. And the truth is, it's a complication. I'm not saying it's bad at all. It's really good. But your life wasn't like that before. And in Jesus, it shifts things for you. I'll give you one more complication. And it's a growing sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. A growing sensitivity. This isn't on your sheet, so I'm just giving you complications here. But when you realize that the Holy Spirit is active and at work in your life as you follow after Jesus, the Bible says that he will guide us, convict us, and challenge us. And you can see it all through scripture. You look at someone like the apostle Peter, and the Holy Spirit began to move in him and work in him, to move him from a fisherman to someone who could stand up in front of thousands and preach the good news. He took Paul, who was someone who persecuted Christians, and shifted and changed his heart to become a missionary for the gospel. And some of your stories are just as dramatic and just as radical, because the Holy Spirit takes people from every walk of life and transforms them into prayer warriors and leaders and people who serve and give unselfishly, and reforms some of them into pastors and missionaries. That's what he does. See, when we were just kind of living our life before, when we had to make decisions, we'd just make a decision. And as you truly follow after Jesus, you're like, hold on. I think we need to pray about this. That's the Holy Spirit at work in you. But what you used to do has changed, and it's a complication in your life, a really good one, but it's a complication nonetheless. And so Jesus warned everyone up front, listen, before you say you're following me, you need to know up front, there's a warning label. There are gonna be complications that come. The benefits far outweigh it, but you need to be aware. Things change. Write this down for number two. Following Jesus means I respond now. Now. Not someday, not one of these days, but now. So I want you to pick it up in Luke chapter 9, starting at verse 59. Here's the second encounter. Jesus said to another person, come follow me. And the man agreed, but he said, Lord, first let me return home and bury my father. And Jesus told him, let the dead bury their own dead. Your duty is to go and preach about the kingdom of God. Now let's be honest. Can we do that? It's church. Like, we can be honest. When we hear that and read that, we go, wow. Like, if you were a disciple, you'd want to go, hey, Jesus, sorry to interrupt. Can I talk to you for a moment? Like, that was harsh. Like, you know, this guy is going, that's what we think when we read it. It's like, what in the world was Jesus thinking? This guy wants to follow Jesus, probably has these really good intentions. He just wants to attend his dad's funeral. It's like, can't Jesus just give him a break? But here's one of the cultural things that kind of bring some understanding and shed some light on this. If you were to read commentaries or theologians, what they will tell you is that Jesus was at, this man and Jesus, this conversation was about a cultural tradition. See, this man's father wasn't dead yet. It sounds like, oh, he's already dead. He's going to, no. It was a tradition, a responsibility as probably an eldest son that he had to manage his father's affairs. And when his father passed away, he would have to arrange all the different things around the funeral and the burial. And then he would have to distribute the wealth to, you know, whatever his father's wishes were. So there were all these responsibilities that came with it. And Jesus was addressing these responsibilities that he was gonna have. And there's nothing wrong with the responsibilities, but what this man was saying really was this: Jesus, I wanna follow you, but not just yet. I got some things that I need to figure out first. I'm really interested. I really wanna go there with you, but you know, there's just a lot of things on my plate right now. So when it's a little bit more convenient, when things are a little bit easier, when I don't have so many responsibilities or expectations, I'm all in, but I'm just gonna postpone it for a while. And Jesus is looking at him, and basically he's saying this: follow me now. Follow me now. See, all of us in this room, we're pretty good at the someday mentality. The one of these days, right? One of these days, I'm going back to school, get my degree. Okay. One of these days, we're gonna take that dream vacation we've always talked about, right? One of these days, I promise, we'll get married, right? We say, one of these days, I'm gonna go to a recovery program. I'm gonna go something like Celebrate Recovery, and I'm gonna really tackle these issues that have gotten the best of me. One of these days, I'm gonna do that. But here's the problem, we all know it. Those some days, those one of these days turns into never. And that's the guy Jesus is addressing in this passage. Someday, someday, but just not now. And Jesus looks him in the eye and says, follow me today. Follow me today. And Jesus was saying, listen, I'm the most important thing you could do right now. A relationship with me is the factor in life here and for eternity. I am it. So will you follow or will you procrastinate? Will you put me off? In 2 Corinthians, Paul writes this. God says, at just the right time, I heard you. On the day of salvation, I helped you. Indeed, the right time is when? Now. Today is the day of salvation. See, the challenge is that some of us in this room, we keep saying someday too. Someday, someday. One of these days. So here's my question. What is it that keeps you from completely and totally surrendering yourself to the lordship and kingship of Jesus? What is it? What is standing in the way? What is the thing out there to say, yeah, when I get there, Dave, man, when I retire, I'm gonna be all in for Jesus. Hey, when I finish school, hey, when I get married, when our kids are out of the house, when, I mean, we've got a million reasons. And Jesus would look at you and say, will you follow me today? Will you be all in today? Because if you get hooked on that someday syndrome, it may well cost you your soul. Will you trust me, follow me, and be all in with me today? Write this down for the third one. Following Jesus may separate me. May separate me. This is a challenging one too. Look at verse 61, Luke 9. Another person, see here these three right in a row, right? Yes, Lord, I will follow you, but first let me say goodbye to my family. But Jesus told him, anyone who puts a hand to the plow and then looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. Again, another one of those passages where you go, wow. I mean, this person just comes and says, let me say goodbye to my family. Seems pretty reasonable. Just a little going away party, just wrapping up some loose ends. Come on, Jesus. But Jesus gives this answer. He says, no one after putting his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. And I'll tell you this, Jesus' answer shows us what's really going on. What this guy wanted to do was not give a hug to his loved ones, because Jesus isn't trying to, you know, break families and do all that. This guy wanted to go home first and check it out with his friends and family. He wanted the approval of those who were close to him. And he was gonna do a little informal poll of his friends and family to go, hey guys, I'm really thinking about following Jesus. What do you think? What do you think? Should I? You know, thoughts? You know, give me some feedback on this. And that's why Jesus said, once you say you're gonna follow me, don't look back. Don't look for a popular vote among your friends and family. Once you decide to follow me, man, push the boat away from the shore and follow me. You see, this decision is yours and no one else's. And so that's why Jesus says, following me is maybe gonna cause some tension between the people you used to be close to. Here's what Jesus says in Luke 12. He says, do you think I've come to bring peace to the earth? No, I've come to divide people against each other. From now on, now listen to this, families will be split apart, three in favor of me and two against, or two in favor and three against. Father will be divided against son, son against father, mother against daughter, daughter against mother, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, daughter-in-law. I mean, he just gives kind of the whole thing there. And what's Jesus saying? That he likes to create conflict in families? No, that's not what he's saying at all. The truth is that when Jesus calls you into a deep relationship with him, some people are gonna say, and some of you have experienced this, your friends and family are gonna go, that is incredible, that is awesome, I love what you're doing. And some people are gonna go, you're kidding me, right? You're gonna become a Christian? You're gonna be one of those religious people? I don't even think I know you. And I can tell you this, if you choose that way, if you're gonna become a Christian and all those things that are going on and you're gonna be holier than thou, I mean, a lot of things get said, I don't even know if I can be your friend anymore. Some of you have walked that road. You may even have the expectations and pressure of culture because following Jesus goes against the grain of our culture. There are things that we hold true and sacred and holy that our culture dismisses and may even label you if you choose to believe and follow. And here's what Jesus says. And I don't think he says it with anger or malice or any of those things, but I think he says, listen, listen. When you choose me, you may face some challenges in your relationships. There may be people who cheer you on, and there may be people who will condemn you for it. But the question is this, who are you going to listen to? Who are you going to listen to? That's gonna be the challenge. And you know, we're really good at competing in a lot of different arenas of life, school and work, maybe even sports or different things like that. But in that challenge to be better and that challenge to push, let me ask you this. Have you ever challenged yourself to become more and more like Jesus? Have you ever challenged anyone else to say, hey, walk with me on this journey, let's follow Jesus together? See, we compete and push in so many areas, and then we get kind of laid back spiritually, and we compromise spiritually, and we neglect these spiritual concerns because we're afraid that someone may not like it. We're afraid of what our friends may think, afraid of being labeled a Christian or being considered godly. And Jesus is saying, I'm telling you right up front, that there will be tension in your relationships when you are all in with me. Expect it. Don't shrink back from it. But to make your stand, because the question is this, who is the Lord of your life? We sometimes ask ourselves, you know, what would everyone think? But the real question is, what does God think? It's probably the most important question you can ever ask yourself. What does God think? What does God think about this conversation that I'm entering into? What does God think about what I'm watching? What does God think about this offering that I'm going to give or about this practice that I should stop? What does God think? You see, the challenge is that someday every single one of us is going to stand before God. Not with our spouse or our kids, our parents or our friends. We're going to stand before God. And it's just going to be us before the king. And the question is, am I willing to kind of cut the cords that tie me to human approval and instead go, you're the one that I want the approval of. You're the one that I serve. You gave your life for me, and so I'm giving all of me to you. Sometimes we just know Jesus as a savior and a friend. But are you willing to take the next step to break any of the things that hold you back, the things that tie you in, and take the bold step of following Jesus and let him be the Lord and the King of your life in every arena? Because what he offers you is more than you can imagine. There is a cost, but it is so worth it because Jesus really does change everything. Would you bow your heads with me today? Jesus, we just thank you that you are faithful and true and good, and you speak life and hope to us. But Lord, I'm grateful that you don't pull any punches. You don't do a bait and switch on us. You tell us clearly up front, if you follow me, you pick up your cross daily. And you walk with me. And Lord, today, that's what we want. not just some surface level thing, not just some nod of the head and just keep on our own path, but Lord, for true transformation to take place in us, it's all in. Lord, today I pray for each person in this room, each person watching online, each person in our live stream, wherever and whoever is watching, there would be this call, this challenge to say, Jesus, I am all in. I am for you and you only. God, in that, what could you do in us? We love you and we thank you today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with me? I am well aware that this passage in Scripture is challenging to us, right? It hits us at that level going, wow, what does this really mean? But I just want to tell you that I am praying for you to go beyond the surface, to go beyond just that first step, and to say, what would it look like in my life to be all in for Jesus? Imagine what would happen if all of us together were all in for Jesus. We truly would be lights in a dark world. We truly would be salt bringing flavor and hope to those around us. That's what Jesus is calling us to. Hey, thanks for being here today. Thanks for joining in, being part of our family. God bless you.